Hey, everybody.
What's up?
What's going on? We are the little... the Late Late Horror Show.
What?
Welcome to the Late Late Horror Show with Dino and Ted.
What?
Yeah, change the name on you guys.
Oh.
We did. We started...
Change the name on me. I found out in the text.
Hey, you like it though, right?
Yes, I do.
Yeah.
I gave him carte blanche to do what he wants with the show.
Yeah, Ted just shows up and talks. I mean, you know.
I just know Monday night I'm supposed to be here.
So, you know what? Let me lower myself. Ooh, okay.
Don't lower yourself to that level.
I changed it because I love the Little Monsters Movie Podcast, but when we started this off, we were new to YouTube, okay? And we really didn't know all the ins and outs, and the name was just too long.
It's 9 syllables.
People couldn't remember it. Wasn't easy to hold on, even though we did really, really well. I mean, I think for a year, we grew big time. And we did good, and we're still doing good. But I thought, you know what, with our format, we do kind of a full movie type thing, more of a podcast, more of a horror show type thing.
Without actually showing you the movie, pretty much.
Audio-wise, right. Yeah. I mean, but video-wise on YouTube, you see clips of the movie.
Yeah, yeah.
So, you know, but if you're listening on iTunes, you're not going to see the actual video. Unless you're listening to me right now, and you can go look us up on YouTube, the Late
really
Late
should, we're really
Horror
good
Show.
Looking.
Oh, I'm like, I wear a low cut shirt with my black chest hairs sitting out, my gold chains.
That's right.
Not even close.
You're Gumby but, gold.
And Ted's most of the time topless with
that's right.
Velveeta cheese melting down his chest.
Yes.
And we have a bowl
my
of nachos.
In it.
But we switched the name, the Late Late Horror Show, because. That's kind of what we are. We're kind of like a horror host type thing where we do the whole movie, talk about it from beginning to end, goof around a little bit. Future, we're going to have like skits and stuff like that. This is evolving still. We're 1 year into this, man.
That's right.
And we're doing good. So now you could kind of... And you know, I kind of dig in the banner and the look of the site now and all that. So black and white's my thing. Got all the classic monsters. And with that said, we are doing... Abbott and Costello Meet Frankenstein, 1948. Another Universal.
Movie?
We've been doing, we're doing a few here. We'll be doing The Mummy, I think the Spanish version of Dracula.
Yes.
And Frankenstein next week, I do believe. So, and then we'll hit back to some of the 80s cheese maybe, or even the 70s Hammer. We'll see some Vincent Price.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So,
yes.
So we've been changing it up a bit. So.
Now I'm getting aroused.
Oh, boy. What is up? And this movie, okay, it's a comedy horror, of course. Abbott Costello. I wanted to do this because this is up there as one of my all-time favorite Universal movies.
It's a beloved
period.
Comedy, period, too.
Oh, yeah. I mean, when you got all the monsters, and we'll talk about that throughout the movie, you know, there's issues. We do have Bella. We do have... Well, we got Glenn Strange, who did play Frankenstein, but Boris Karloff didn't, and we'll talk about it, yeah. And, of course, Lon Chaney.
Yeah, two in a row.
And I talked about, in The Wolfman, how bad his acting was, and I talked a little bit about how it was a lot more convincing in this film, but then after watching it again, I'm like going...
About the same.
Man, he sucks. I am sorry. The poor guy...
He's great as The Wolfman.
No, he is, yeah. And his character in this movie was good, but his acting sucked. Compared to even Abbott and Costello, who was acting
it's
next
adequate.
To him.
It's adequate. I mean, it is what it is.
You're going...
And he acted better than Glenn Strange did, so I mean, I guess...
Oh, yeah, we'll talk about it. Why in the hell is his eyes closed, Ted, the whole movie? I can't see where I'm going, but I can open the door.
I cannot see.
What? I'm trying to remember back. Why is his eyes closed in this movie?
To make him look more menacing, I think.
Oh, but I love this movie. Abbott and Costello, they're...
Well,
I think we're
Abbott and Costello fans anyway.
Big Abbott and Costello. They've done over 40 films, okay?
Yeah, definitely.
They did, and all of them are great. Most all of them are comedies. Well, they're all comedies. But horror-wise, they got Abbott and Costello Meet the Killer, Abbott and Costello Meet Invisible Man, The Mummy, Frankenstein.
Mummy's a good one.
This one's the best of them all.
Yes.
Mummy's good, too. Invisible Man's good, too. Jekyll and Hyde was one of their last films they ever did. Wasn't the best. They kind of went out of favor from there. And they ended up going into TV series in the 50s.
Right.
That's right when...
The Costello Show?
TV series. The Abbott Costello
Show. That was like a way for them to work in all their old skits. And it was a way for them TV to own them. They own that show. And now, I don't know if like later on in life they lost the rights to things like that.
Probably.
Because of taxes. They had some tax issues later on in their in life. And I think they ended up losing their rights. But the idea of their TV show was because, you know, all those great skits that were in the radio shows and the movies, they didn't own those.
Yeah.
So this was a way for them to rework the skits and actually own it.
Exactly.
So, you know, but I think with tax issues, back taxes, they ended up losing their houses and a lot of those rights that they had.
Yeah, this happened a lot to a lot of the old comics back in the day. I mean, you can go back to Lauren Hardy and even the Three Stooges.
Marx Brothers got chased out of the country.
Yeah,
Chaplin wasn't allowed back in
Groucho
the country.
Marx was pretty much one of the ones that they made out probably better than a lot of these ones that, I mean, because the way they... They're just smarter with their contracts.
Finally putting
Marx
Brothers out on Blu-ray, guys. Nice set with all the classic movies. Animal
and if you
crackers,
don't, if you're
horse feathers.
Oh my god!
I'm getting that. That's going to be a Christmas present for me.
I love the Marx Brothers too. Well, you know me and Ted. We love all the old.
Can you imagine like their mother living in the house with them? Just
mother, what do you think?
He's just shaking her head. My god.
Hey, honey, you want some eggs? Well, I tell you what, you want two eggs here?
They all have different accents. What do you mean we get us some eggs?
You mix them up and scramble them, no? Anyways, So we got Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein, 1948. Of course, Abbott and Costello,
Lon Chaney. Late 30s,
plays
and
the
Wolfman. Radio, all the way through, you know.
Yeah, because they did
almost the 60s.
They did the old-time radio shows, too, like most of these.
You know what I read that was interesting? I was reading up on... Just Abbott and Costello, is that when they first started out on the radio, their voices were actually kind of similar. Lou Costello, he's the short, fat one, if you don't know. His voice is not the voice that you see in the movies and stuff. He does that intentionally because his normal speaking voice was almost like Bud Abbott's, and people on the radio couldn't tell them apart.
You mean
too
Costello?
Well. Yeah, I'm sorry.
Lou Costello.
Lou Costello. Is that what I said?
He's a skinny guy. You're talking. Whichever. Go ahead.
No.
Who had to change their voice?
You know.
Hey, Abbott!
Yeah.
No, so but oh my God, we're getting confused. Abbott Costello did that to you all these years. you mix up Bud Abbott and Lou Costello, which is the fat one.
Lou Costello
is the fat one.
Yes, he made his voice purposely a little bit higher to that kind of, so that people would be able to tell the difference. I didn't know that. I never knew that. That was intentional, that his voice is like that.
Oh, yeah.
So there you go.
Cool.
You should do that. You do the high-pitched voice. And
I'll start that movie there.
Yeah, let's start the flick.
But
Uni.
We got Lon Chaney Jr. plays the Wolfman again, of
Larry
course.
Larry Talbot. Now, it doesn't make any sense because in the last... There hadn't been a monster movie for 3 years. The last one was House of Dracula.
And people gotta look at this beginning.
Oh, yeah, let's talk about the beginning.
The animated, cartoonish... It was done by Walter Lance, who did
Woody Woodpecker. You knew that, huh?
Oh, yeah. And so you get a lot of that through here, especially when Bela Lugosi turns into the bat in most of the movie.
Mm-hmm.
That's a cartoon from Walter Lance
who
did that. So it's just,
do they even
cool.
know who Woody Woodpecker is? I wonder. Oh, and I love when they all come out there, the Wolfman, Dracula. And this is actually, before I go on to what I was going to say, this is the second time that Bela Lugosi played Dracula in a film.
Right.
And the last time that he played. Now, there were some like TV appearances and things like that.
Yes, he's played other roles
and
stuff like that.
Played other vampires.
Right.
But this was the second and last time. And they weren't even going to give it to him. It was going to go to another actor. I can't remember the name. And Bela Lugosi's agent marched in that office and basically guilt-tripped them into giving it to him. Saying, you know, how can you do this to him? You owe it to him.
Mm-hmm.
He is Dracula.
Exactly.
And they gave it to him. Now, I don't know if it was like public knowledge at the time that this movie came out that he had like his drug problems and things like that.
Yeah.
I know that was more like in the 50s.
His heroin, yeah.
So,
this
morphine,
was...
Shooting a morphine, I think he was hooked on. A
few years after this movie, London Fog, this... Mm-hmm. And I have to say, the atmosphere to this movie, too, just goes right along Universal. Everything is just beautiful in this movie,
yeah.
I think. I love the setting. I love everything about it.
Scenes here.
And the funny thing is about this movie. What is the funny thing about this movie?
Most everything, Costello. Really. But
no, it's actually the second cheapest film Universal did at the time.
Yeah, I was reading about that. And it
ended up being the second highest moneymaker for that year.
That was the thing with these monster movies. They didn't cost that much to make. They recycled the sets.
Yeah.
You had the same guy doing the makeup and all that. You got cheap actors. And they made they made tons of money.
About this movie, though, this is still, even still, this was such a good film. You wouldn't notice that it was the cheapest one they made.
Right.
And the Bud Abbott and Lou Costello, how their performances just are great in this movie. I mean, it is just overwhelming. If nobody, this is a horror show, and a lot of people watching this knows our horror shows that we've done in the past.
Mm-hmm.
Take it from me, man. Give Abbott and Costello a chance. If you like dumb humor, okay, and just really whimsical type cheap laughter, this is it, man. And I can't go on enough about how much I love this stuff.
They're great. The way they figure into this film is Larry Talbot, who's the Wolfman.
Mm-hmm.
He's in London.
Which is another thing. The Wolfman plays a bigger role than Frankenstein, but yet it's Abbott and Costello meets Frankenstein.
I know, Frankenstein plays very little role in this film.
Yeah,
I mean,
it's very strange. It's very Glenn Strange.
Very Glenn Strange. Clever. And Abbott and Costello by the names of Wilbur and Chick in the film. They are...
Wilbur's the fat one.
Yep, and Chick's Abbott.
And what a name they give him. Chick! Hey, Chick!
And they work in a Florida... railway depot. They work Florida. Like in the bag handling.
He works in Florida.
Florida.
You want me to go get your grip?
Florida. Yeah, a grip.
You want me to get
so
your
it starts grip? Off there in there, but the phone's ringing and there's a lady at the bell. Get the phone! Get the bell! Get the phone! Get the... And it's
back
it's
and
always
forth. Dumb
it's
humor.
Always you know Abbott barking orders at Lou, and he's always torn between two things. Doesn't know what he's supposed to do.
Yeah, that's pretty much been their thing from the beginning.
Right.
You know.
Yeah, Abbott's the straight man, the straight cranky man, and Lou's the dim-witted kind of one, but who I think's
lovable, great. Man.
And yeah. I gotta say, one thing I love about this movie is that the two hot chicks in this movie are both chubby chasers. Right? Because they're both going after Lou.
Ted's loving it.
I love it. There's hope. There's hope for us husky guys.
Oh, man. The first one, though, Sandra.
Yeah.
Joan, though.
Joan, yeah.
Joan looked good. She was your typical blonde
50s. After he goes to grab somebody's suitcase, it's on a big cart. And it's like there's 8,000 suitcases on top of it. And he pulls it out and they all come crashing down. The phone rings. He goes to answer it. This is Lou, the fat one. When I say Lou, I mean the fat one. Wilbur.
Yeah, because the Wolfman.
It's Larry Talbot.
Is saying, calling him from London.
Do you have a crate going to McDougal's House of Horrors? You
no, can't. Can I say it like.
Oh,
do you have two crates going to. I'm trying to be as bad actor as I can. Because
oh, he's
that's
not
how,
that bad.
He goes, oh, because I. No, I really need to get a hold of them.
He's chasing down Dracula and Frankenstein.
But do you like
reason.
How he first. First of all, he goes, you know how long it takes to get this... I know how long it takes for this call to get through
calling
London
the operator.
To the U.S. Now, you know, it's like we...
How long does it take? I don't know. How long did it take back then?
Guess they have
half
to go...
an hour? I mean...
I don't know. Switchboard to switchboard. I think I got someone in Tallahassee.
What do you got? You got, I mean, you know, Myrtle on the other end with the cigarette and putting the cords in the...
Okay, here we go.
But while he's on the phone, he starts changing into the Wolfman because the full moon's coming.
Mm-hmm.
And there's all kinds of growling and barking and Wilbur's under like, you know, mister, it seems awful stupid to call me all the way from London if you know, just for your dog to be barking on the phone.
Yeah, that's what he says.
Yeah, something like that.
Because he's turned into a werewolf.
And the makeup, the transition is a little bit smoother than it's been in previous films.
Yeah.
This is the fifth and last time that Lon Chaney played the Wolfman. And, I was also going to say that this film doesn't exactly make sense in the canon of the Universal movies because in 1945, House of Dracula, he was cured.
Yeah.
And, so, I don't know, I guess we can assume he got bit by a werewolf again. if you want to. I think this is just like a standalone.
Yeah, this is a standalone campy kind of film because that's why they kind of did all of this. Mm-hmm. But and a for lot 3 of years,
there had been no more monster movies. I mean, well, at least the main, you know, Dracula, Frankenstein, the Mummy. There had been no more of those movies.
And a lot of them really were hesitant on making this film, right?
Yeah, well, I mean, some people weren't sure it was going to be a good idea. Lou Costello really didn't like the idea. He claimed that his daughter, his 7-year-old daughter, could write a better story than this. He warmed up to it later on, yeah. You know, because as we'll talk about later on, they did some stuff in between mm-hmm. takes to keep, you know, keep comedy going. And it sounds pretty cool
what they
would do.
Goofing around with him and stuff on the set.
Oh, absolutely.
To keep the humor up.
And then I like this guy that shows up. This is actually Mr. McDougal.
Mr. McDougal of the
House of Horrors. And I can't remember his name, but...
McDougal's House of Horrors.
You've seen him before. And if you look at his credits, if you watched any of the old 50s, 60s, 70s TV shows, he's in all of them. Especially Westerns.
Yeah.
But, I mean, he's been in Leave It to Beaver and I mean, Lassie. And if you know some of those old shows, you've seen his face.
Yeah, and 21 Jump Street. He plays the detective on there.
Yeah, he was the one that would always infiltrate the high schools, posing as the kid.
Yeah,
but he was about 80.
And remember when we said, "Well, how, I don't believe that for a second."
Yeah.
But anyways,
so where's my crates? I've got 2 very valuable crates.
Yes,
and he tells him right out what they are.
$20,000.
You know, apiece. Yeah, that he's
and
got
you
got
to love how
he's got. Wilbur, says he's got the remains of Dracula and the body of the Frankenstein monster.
And he goes up on top of the just gigantic crate.
What the hell?
And just starts pulling him down.
How do they keep him on there?
And
must have been like straps for his feet or something. Because that's him up there.
Well, no,
that was great. Look at check,
check, check, check. But do you like how he just flops and there it is. He goes, there you go.
So McDougal
sees
doesn't
care what he broke in there.
Yeah, well, he sees they're manhandling his packages and says, you know, now you're going to deliver them up to my house.
Do you think that's one giant crate with 2 crates in it?
No, there's 2.
No, that crate right there is about
15
feet long.
I don't know. You're right. It is a big crate for just one body.
But then again, the Frankenstein monster... It's tall.
And there's all that Excelsior in there.
Yeah. McDougal's House of Horrors.
So he says they're going to deliver it, uncrate it, and he's going to have his insurance agent inspect it before he accepts delivery on it because he's afraid they've manhandled it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, evidently it's their job to deliver this crap as well. So they do that.
Yeah.
And I like these kind of... I mean, I wish there were more places like this. These House of Horrors, these wax museums. You know where I know... Well, they're not like this... But, like, if you go to Niagara Falls and stuff like that, I remember they had, like, the wax museums and things like that.
Yeah.
But not exactly like this.
No. Back then, they used to set them up in, like, little display sections.
Mm-hmm.
Like, kind of like if you were to go through a haunted house now at Halloween.
Exactly.
It was kind of exactly like that at a higher scale. Wax mm-hmm. figures and great gigantic props and stuff like that.
Cool.
Wilbur's going to be the...
Oh, as he's backing in with the first
the
crate.
Scared one. Like always, in all these movies, Wilbur's always scared.
Well, God, he backs up and he gets an axe in his back. Somebody pulled a knife on me.
And Lou's, I'll call him Chick.
Chick
goes, come on. Like he always does. Look around. Turn
around. Come on, it's just imagination. They're all made out of wax.
What's wrong with you? You're an idiot.
We're going to find that.
Oh, Chick.
It's kind of one of those movies where every time Wilbur's around, stuff's going down. And then every time he wants somebody to see it, it's gone.
Ah, it's all in your exactly. mind. Wilbur.
Half the movie is that kind of stuff.
You idiot.
So.
Yeah.
But I'm going to go on record and say, you know, maybe I just don't find this movie as humorous as I used to. I still like it. But, like we were saying, you know, how Lou didn't care for the story. The story is very thin.
Yeah.
Which we'll get into as we go.
I don't know. But I see a lot of funny... There's a lot of... Whimsical,
funny bits
to this movie
that
are original and
great. That's what makes it good.
I mean, if you're going to get in-depth on the monsters,
the
storyline with that.
I knew going in you loved it, so I figured I got to do something a little different. We can't just both be gushing
on this. No.
But by no, I mean, I own the movie, so don't get me wrong. You know, it was Jerry Garcia's favorite movie.
One of mine.
Not that I'm a Grateful Dead fan, but it's.
But you know what? I come from the point of. I love every Abbott and Costello film.
Right.
There's not a bad one for me. You know, so in that aspect, I'm just a gigantic fan of this, of them two alone. Right. So to put them in this horror movie is just...
It's a good type of movie for them to be in, especially with Lou Costello, about, you know, just being in that situation where you're afraid, because he does that so well.
Yes.
You know, that
and there's a couple movies they've done that are really, really good like that. Like Meets the Killer, where Boris
Isn't there a ghost one, too?
What's it called? Oh, God. See, I'm bad with remembering things, even though I've seen it a million times.
There's a ghost one of theirs as well, I remember.
Yeah, and one where they get stranded at a haunted house.
Yeah,
and,
maybe that's it.
And no, that's a different one, and that's why I can't remember which one it is. But anyways, that's a really good one.
But this was a way for Universal to put like two of their big things together. They had Abbott and Costello, who was a big money maker, and they had the Universal Monsters, which were kind of puttering out. And it's like, hey, what about the idea of just mashing them both together?
And it was kind of, I don't know, that part of this is kind of dumb. I mean, they try to make it cohesive and make sense, but yeah, as the storyline through the Universal Monsters, it makes no sense. Right. And what they're even doing. And even Count Dracula, Bella in here, he's just overdoing the thing around it. But maybe they tried to make it funny, even though... I heard that Bella was like a kind of... Man, this guy gets pissed easy. I mean, he didn't like any humor. I'm surprised he even did this, you know?
Like when we were talking about things that would happen in between takes.
Yeah.
They would have pie fights. they had a couple of extra comedians. They would just come on in and liven things up in between takes. Keep people laughing.
Yeah.
And I was reading up today that, you know, Bella always thought it was funny as long as it didn't involve him.
Right.
And so, like, the one time when... It's a part coming up later when he's in the castle,
walking down the steps. Yeah.
And the guy was, like, behind him when he didn't know it and, like, mimicking him, mocking him a little bit. And when he realized it, he got ticked off. You know, just, you should not be playing when we are working. You know?
And stomped off the set.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
So, I mean, you know, it was funny when it didn't involve him. Yeah, so... I love the idea of pie fights.
And it could be the morphine, you know, talking there.
Oh, but I also read that they were very respectful of the monsters in the pie fights because they went through, even though makeup had gotten better, they went through all that trouble to get the makeup on. They made sure not to smash them in the face with pies. But as we find
out, I love it, man.
They uncrate the coffin. Yes. It's a coffin and it's got Dracula's crest on it.
And Chick goes, look! It's Count Dracula's crest on there. You know, like, immediately, he just knew it, knew the lore, you know, it's like...
Well, who doesn't, you know? Because the guy's already got literature posted about, you know, these things. And,
but Mr. McDougal, who obtained these two things from, you know...
Well, he didn't even obtain it. He says that someone contacted him and basically sold them to him for practically nothing.
But he knew there were bodies in there. I mean, what...
That's what he knows is supposed to be in there. He hasn't seen them yet.
Okay, he did never see. And this is a classic scene, the candle coming down.
Oh, yeah, that's from another movie. I think that maybe that Haunted House movie.
Yes, yes.
It's a little bit from that movie. But
why don't I know that?
So, Wilbur's in there reading some of the literature.
And this is where he goes, Chick!
Yeah, while Chick's out there getting the other crate.
Well, Chick!
And he sees that...
Sorry, I'm gushing here.
No, because that's exactly what he does for half an hour.
Oh, Chick! Yeah.
Chick! And the coffin opens up, you see Bela Lugosi's hand come out a little bit, closes back up. And when he's trying to do the whistle, Chick!
There's a Dracula. Yeah, and of course, Dracula's got
because he was reading something, and the coffin lid was opening, and he had a candlestick because the power went out.
Yeah.
And the candle's sliding down the edge of the coffin.
Yeah, and Chick comes down, and he goes... What do you mean?
What, the there's candle the candle moved by itself.
The candle's right there. Is it moving? No, it ain't moving. See? what are you talking about? Come on. Yeah.
And I don't know if it's happened yet when he's like, you know, if you need anything, just yell, you know, yell Chick and I'll come. Chick! You know, right as soon as he turns around. Does it three? Wait, I didn't even leave the room yet. What took you so long?
Does it three or four times? Yeah, I mean, you know.
Took you so long? Don't take so long next time.
At least. Yeah. and he goes right back to reading this.
Oh, there it goes again.
Legend of Dracula. And of course, you know. Yeah, the candle starts flowing down, and
Chick. But this time he's gonna hop out. But this there time, we go. Yeah, there he is.
Bella gets out of the casket.
He's moving pretty spry for an old dude.
Yeah.
But look at this, man.
Well, he doesn't look that much, from the original.
No, not really.
I mean, and look at it. When Chick's coming with the other crate, all he does, he's blatantly walking away and just holds his cape up like this. And he's just standing in the back.
As he was pushing it.
But he was walking.
I know. He should have seen him walking towards the back. He should have seen some movement,
but I didn't notice it. But if we get to, like, the basic...
You done did.
Done did.
Mm-hmm.
I saw what I saw when I saw it. But basically, the overall gist of this movie is that Dracula is trying to reanimate the Frankenstein monster.
No.
And this time he wants to do it by giving him a brain that is, I guess, a little bit more pliable. And so when he meets, in this place here, when he meets Wilbur...
He's connected with Sandra, the doctor.
Right, right. Wilbur's girlfriend, the one that we mentioned before, the chubby chaser.
Yeah, who's got a hold of Wilbur.
Working with Dracula.
And pretty much says
we don't know that yet in the movie.
Right.
But
pretty much says, yeah, I've got this dumb fat guy who will do anything we say. As if the Frankenstein monster now...
Right. And that's basically the story. But they just throw in Lon Chaney as that, like, he's tracking them down.
Yeah.
Trying to stop this. Not to get himself cured or anything, really. Excuse me. Yeah. Sorry, too much water.
Oh, he's drowning.
Yeah, he's just in it.
He's drowning.
He's just in it, And really, like we were saying, even though Frankenstein figures in it...
Is he in it to win it?
He's in it to win it. They want to put Wilbur's brain into him. Otherwise, Frankenstein really plays very little role in the movie.
Yeah, no.
It's more the Wolfman than anything else.
Exactly. And that's what threw me a bit.
Yeah.
I mean, they had...
A better title would have been...
I mean, it's fine. I mean, over all these years, we understand...
Or maybe he was the most popular one. Maybe Frankenstein was the most popular one, so that's why they did it.
Could be.
You know, I really don't know why they picked...
Meet Dracula?
It could have been Dracula. It could have been the Wolfman. It could have been...
I mean, I know the story...
Meet the Monsters.
The story would be Meet the Monsters.
Yeah.
Yeah, you know what? Abbott and Costello, Meet the Monsters. But, yeah, I don't know. Yeah, I get, you know, to think about it in retrospect here.
Oh, we see Frankie for the first time. Oh, so while they're bringing in the other crate and chit-chatting, Dracula sneaks back into his coffin. They do hear as they're uncrating the Frankenstein monster, you can hear Dracula's coffin creakings. And did you hear that, chick? Yeah, I heard it. Are you just pulling up some nails? Yeah, and even the... Oh, God. Remember he backs into the guillotine and it chops off the head?
Knocks off the head. And he gets ready to go throw it in the casket. Dracula's back in the casket and he drops it down. And this is where he gets... Well, before that, they do open up the Frankenstein casket, and he is just laying there.
You do see his face. He's in there.
And they throw it back over. But this is where Dracula kind of hypnotizes Wilbur. And you got to love how he's got... I mean, it's just overdone.
What's the deal with the cloak over the cape over the face?
Just so he can stare into his eyes, and all you look at is the eyes.
Yeah, he does this about 17 times in this movie.
Oh, yeah. It's
He can do it, man.
Well, I think he had coke all over his nose and mouth.
That's why he did.
So they didn't want him, But yeah, Bella with his hand motions when he hypnotizes, like...
I read in the Ed Wood biography that he actually thought that he could hypnotize people. That, I mean, he thought that he could do it.
I wouldn't put it past him.
He'd be going up to women.
He was probably half...
Trying some of that Hungarian voodoo on him.
Well, he was probably high most of the time he was talking to Ed Wood.
I don't know.
And he probably was going, Ed.
Eddie.
I can hypnotize you.
Just like that movie. That was a great movie. Oh. Ed Wood.
And Ed Wood probably was high too. And in his bra and panties. And he probably went, here we go. This is very strange. What?
Well, the way that he's... Yeah, I don't know what he's doing with Frankenstein's mom.
No.
He's got some ring, Dracula. He picks some of the Excelsior up. And he...
Which evidently has a million volts in this
electricity.
Ring.
Yeah.
Like, I take off my ring.
Over here on the bolt. Over here on the neck bolt. And he wakes up.
And, but, no, no. But he, Ted, he don't just do it on the sides, which, first of all, the little lightning bolts are, like, cartoonish, which is kind of cool.
Right.
But then he also takes the ring and put it on each his forehead. Eye.
Yeah, no,
each eyelid. You all right?
Excuse me,
you
yes.
You going to be able to stay awake?
Well, I was at work all day today. But I'll be able to do it.
Poor Ted, man. I drag him in here after a 12-hour shift.
That's right.
And he gets ready to talk about these movies.
I do it for you. Yeah. I look forward to it all day, though.
Oh, good, good.
I do.
Let's take a moment of silence and drink.
All right. So, yeah, what is he? He hops out of the crate there.
No moment of silence?
Yes, master. Oh God!
There's the minute he was,
he looks at Wilbur and gets scared.
Why is he scared of Wilbur?
I have no idea. Maybe because he's smarter than he is.
But he did snap out of because the reason I asked is because
look at those boots. They're like that thick. It's like a Big Mac.
It's like a Big Mac. There's figures everywhere. I know they're wax, but there's figures everywhere else.
Yeah.
So the Frankenstein monsters
are hiding. To know. It's just, you know, all Dracula has to do is this to hide. And then, like Frankenstein's monsters. I'm just going to call him Frankenstein. Fuck it. And he's like hiding in behind the curtain. You see his face sticking out.
Wonder how many knew that Glenn Strange did the Frankenstein most of the time.
Yeah, it's a shame. I guess Boris Karloff just really didn't want anything to do with this. He actually didn't even want to see the movie. Even though he agreed to do
some promotional stuff.
Right, and there's pictures of him. You can read this all over the internet. There's pictures of him buying tickets at the movie theater.
It's all over the internet?
Well, yeah, and on DVD documentaries.
Holy
crap. But he had no desire to watch this movie. I don't know if it's because it was a comedy and not a horror film or, maybe he felt it was.
Even though he did a film earlier with them.
But that was a different film. He wasn't reprising a character that...
That's true.
I think I'd still take, Frankenstein and Bride of Frankenstein as a pretty serious movie. It was treated very seriously.
Yeah.
And maybe he just didn't want to...
There's the cartoon and all the monster in the movies, castle.
All the monster movies were, took themselves seriously, I think, for the most part.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe he just didn't want to kind of poke fun.
Maybe.
Yeah. That's what I'd like to think.
But the subsequent Frankensteins, you think he would have carried on with the... But anyway, he wanted to broaden. He played a lot of roles in a lot of different movies.
God,
so
man, remember
he said, "You know what? I'm not going to make my life just Frankenstein. If you want to continue to make it with somebody else. I'm going to go off and do my
but
other
sometimes
films."
Sometimes he did other films,
right.
Like they weren't. You know,
there's the cartoon. Walter Lance did that
of the bat of transformation into Dracula,
yes,
which I like.
Time.
That's a cool effect in this movie.
And him flying up to that castle, which is another
somewhere,
very odd, strange.
Somewhere in Florida, off the coast of Florida, there's a Dracula's castle, and he's knocking on the door, and
it has a gigantic knocker, though.
Oh, God.
My, what a big knocker you have.
I love big knockers.
Oh, Sandra.
Sandra.
You have such a big knocker, Sandra. It's one uno knocker topper.
Uno knocker.
He goes, ah.
Welcome.
Welcome. Can I come in, Sandra?
Oh, God. Doesn't he have to be invited in?
She got very tiny, pointy toppers to her.
Oh, God.
Okay, yeah, I know. She poke eyes out with those. She poke eyes out.
That's
with
how
those.
They were back then. Hey, you guys, all the Braziers like that.
Jeez, don't.
There used to be a teacher in my junior high school. Like
but do you
that.
Like how he comes in and? Oh, I'm
she
sorry,
taught home ec, and we used to call her torpedo tits.
Yes,
but she was old, man. But she still.
But
wore
she
a
had
bra
some big toppers.
Well, yeah, but we weren't.
You guys. Well, you were young kids.
I mean,
though. You really. To this day, you remember it. You think about it.
Torpedo tits.
You don't. Oh, wow.
That's what we call them.
What the hell is that? What the. It's the Frankenstein monster.
Yeah, so he's got Frank out
the
and back.
Monster mash.
And what is she doing? Shining a light in his eyes there?
Well, first of all, she's a doctor. She goes, it looks like his pulse is regular.
Yeah, looking at his eye. Yeah, he's got a regular pulse.
Don't you like how Bella walks into the castle? Mm-hmm. First of all, I can't get over the castle, how it's off the coast of Florida somewhere down
right.
there.
I'd like to know where that. I'd like to vacation there.
And when Dracula does fly up as a bat, They show him, first of all, look in the window at Dr. Stevens, the male.
Yeah, he plays, like, no real part in this movie
He doesn't,
at all.
Not at all.
He's just, like, doctor who's working there.
Yeah, he's helping out, like, he's the
Sandra,
assistant.
Sandra, we're going to find, has come across Dr.
Sandra.
Frankenstein's notes.
Sandy!
Hey, Sandy!
It's, like, really weird. Glenn Strange did the Frankenstein master. It's really weird. Anyways.
She has come across, we'll find later, Dr. Frankenstein's notebook. And so she's the one that's actually going to be doing the experiment. She's the one that's going to be doing the, what is it, a brain transplant?
Yeah, because later you'll see the book. What's the book title?
I don't know. Dr. Frankenstein's Notes? I don't know.
Okay, we'll see when we get to it.
I can't remember.
But yeah, for some reason, they're...
Get up, you son of a bitch!
you damn asshole, get up!
Yes, master.
Oh, yes, I'm so pooped. You must feed me.
Oh, God.
I need food.
And they're back at home, and there's Wilbur. I saw what I saw when I saw it. Don't you love how before all these guys back then used to go to bed, they'd brush their hair?
Yes. Yeah, with the gleam or gleam.
Yeah, they got like Dapper Dan in there and the hair pomade.
And you'd always wake up with a black mark on your pillow.
God.
I knew my wife's dad kind of dyed his hair black. Used that kind of like, not dye, but it was a thing they put
shoe
in there.
Polish.
It's almost like they grease it back with a colored, like, mm-hmm. you know, and it would always leave a big black mark on the wherever the head was leaning against. It's
like a recliner chair.
Oh, no, yeah. It's like, oh, my God. Aww. But anyways, they're back at their wherever they are. They're in a motel.
Apartment. I think their apartment.
You think it's their apartment?
God, I hate that.
Okay, you're true. And they're sleeping together in their own bed. They're it's right.
And he's got his robe and he's telling them, "This is what I saw." You know, he's doing his Dracula thing.
And he said he looked like I looked in. He looked in.
He looked right in my eyes and hypnotized me.
And this is when Chick acts like he actually Wilbur hypnotized him. Yeah. And he goes and he walks away. And I love see. If you're watching a video here, every movement that Wilbur does, it's just so great, and it's what's funny about him.
They were great, you know. He was a great straight man, and I would love it when he said, "Hey, check," because he thinks he hypnotized me. He smacks him.
Always slapping him.
Oh God, Larry Talbot's in town.
Shows up at the
happens to rent an apartment right across from.
Yeah,
him.
He got lucky.
Yeah, it's hard to get that apartment.
And he comes in, and this is where he wins his Oscar.
I'm Larry Talbot. I spoke to you on the phone.
And he wins an Oscar for this performance here.
Where are those packages? I specifically told you not to deliver those crates. I mean...
And that's when Wilbur kind of starts going, see, I told you. He believes me. He knows.
this guy believes me.
And Chick actually goes, "You're both crazy." You know. Chick saying this to to Larry Talbot, who's like really, really
God,
big.
Lon Chaney was huge.
Which is another reason I'll tell you, Ted. Okay,
we're going to look at this when the movie
Lon
goes.
Chaney is supposed to play the Wolfman in every movie, okay?
I'm saying he did it.
When you look at him after he's transformed, look at the body type, his movement. Take a real good look, Ted, at him.
Well, when he's looks the Wolfman, like he plays a different kind of character.
But he looks like a very, a much shorter, thinner man.
You know what we're going to do? We're going to pay attention to his height line in his apartment.
Do that, okay.
And then when he's the Wolfman. But when he's the Wolfman, he always crouches down
a little bit. Yeah.
But we could probably guesstimate when he stands up. All right, we're going to watch for this, folks.
Yeah, take a good look and think about it. Because
Dino thinks it wasn't Lon Chaney. I got to say it was because...
I'm thinking it was no big deal back then in the 40s, so long ago, to have a stunt person go into the makeup and do this.
Lon wouldn't let nobody else do that. So Lon says, you know,
see, I mean, look,
the full moon's coming soon. Lock me in my apartment.
Okay, that,
so
that
he
way.
He gives Lou the key, Wilbur, tells him to lock him in the apartment, and he does. Mm-hmm. Goes back to his apartment, realizes he forgot his suitcase. Well, I better go give him his suitcase. Little B knows that he's already transformed into the Wolfman when we get over there.
Yeah, he did pretty darn quickly.
Yeah, it happens fast. It happens fast.
But I love how Chick just thinks they're both a couple of loons.
Yeah, pretty much.
He's like,
go
give
the
crazy guy his suitcase.
Oh, and I
gotta
love how, at the beginning when they're at the train depot, you know, Chick just can't believe that this girl likes Wilbur.
Right.
And he constantly is saying to me, you know, "What's he got that I haven't got?" You know, and
he's got the brains.
Yeah, brains.
Sandra,
which double
Sandra says
there.
He's got the brains.
And yeah, he just can't believe that, you know, a good looking dame like that is going for a guy like you.
And here we come.
All right, let's take a good look. He's going to come out the closet here.
Yep.
I mean, you could be.
I mean, he's
crouched a little bit, but
look how thin those legs are.
Well, I didn't get a good. They didn't show his legs before.
Well, look how skinny
so,
that leg.
Wilbur's back
is,
in the apartment.
Anyways, yeah,
and he can't find
Larry Talbot.
He's in the bathroom.
Yeah.
Changing to Wolfman. He keeps, like, shutting the door every time the Wolfman's trying to come out. And he's just going to leave him a note.
And it's one of those comedic things. But it's cool
because, yeah, he's right there about to pounce on him.
And as soon as he gets up, he dashes at him. And yeah. See how he's crouching down? And even if he stands up straight, there he goes.
It could be. Look how tall he is there.
You know what, Ted? I'm just. I don't.
You're not
know.
Convinced yet, are you?
I'm not. But anyways, right. He steals
the apple.
The apple. I love and this. When he's
this
in
this scene goes on like 5 minutes.
Yeah. Though. Locks the door, and he starts going.
He might have counted.
He might have counted.
He was gonna go back in and put it back. He's like, but maybe he didn't. You know, maybe.
And he accidentally drops the apple and makes him think twice. He goes, ow. You know what? Maybe he didn't.
Maybe count he didn't count. Who counts the apples in the room? No, I think it's him.
When he's standing at the door, he looks like Lon Chaney. When the sequences are in action, I swear he looks nothing like Lon Chaney.
Well,
in body or build or movement. And
we'll watch it every time it happens in the film here.
I mean, I could be wrong, but if somebody knows.
But you could be right. I didn't read anything. I don't think it was
right.
That said that. So I just don't.
Because I don't think the movie companies and stuff like that, I don't think it was as big a deal back then as it was now. Like now, you would get the credit for that.
I mean, he even started out as like a stuntman. He did stunts. He did the falling off the horses and stuff like that. I don't think he would have had a problem doing those things.
I don't think so either, but I just questioned all this. So it's just a question I throw out there. All
right. Well, we're going to watch.
So we'll see.
We do have to mention there's a scene the next morning. Mm-hmm. McDougal at the insurance agent. You know, he's ticked off because the bodies are gone. Mm-hmm. You know, we established that at the horror house.
Yeah.
And before the insurance company is going to pay out whatever, 20 G's or whatever, they're going to do an investigation. Oh. And sure enough, they've got their top investigator in her. Her name is Joan. A little blonde, looking good. And she thinks that... we forgot to mention that, you know... That they got taken to jail.
Yes.
We forgot to mention that once the bodies weren't there, McDougal had police with him, and he took those guys to jail, Abbott and Costello. And they got bailed out. And that's what they're talking about when I said, you know, they were brushing their hair before they went to bed and all that. They assumed that it was Sandra that bailed them out. They didn't know. They just knew it was a woman who bailed them out. Turns out it was this insurance agent. Because she's thinking, especially with, there we go. Especially Wilbur, that she could probably get him to talk. So she's going to work on him.
Mm-hmm.
You got plans?
No, I know. Yeah, so what, she thinks she's going to put one over on Wilbur, and she does. She's a new love interest.
Right, right. So she pops...
Stay down her, Danny.
What
are you doing?
Get out of here. It's not your show.
He's trying to get into our business. Anyways, so basically
She didn't come right out and say that she's an insurance agent, does she? Assurance detective?
No, she's just...
I forgot. What does she say she
is? Oh, my God. What does she say?
Because she shows up at their apartment, you know, and she starts making the moves on Wilbur right away. And
why can't I remember
and
what
she said?
And
there's Chip, again, not being able to believe it. What? I can't...
Yeah, because she's, like, interested in him and, like, you know, she's his
new
love interest.
She says something about... You know what? She feigns that, I think, that she saw him at the bus depot. Or I mean, at the train depot. She says something like, when I saw you at the train station, I couldn't take my eyes off you or something
right. Yeah,
it's something like that.
And Chick pulls him against the light. He goes, get over here by the light. I need to get a good glimpse of you and see what's going on. What are you women seeing in this guy?
What are women seeing
this
in
this little
you?
Chubby little funny looking guy there.
Chicks like the chubby guys. We you know.
Hey, you watching? Well, you don't watch it. There's a Big Brother U.S. version right now. There's this girl, what's her name, Tiffany?
Yeah?
She's an NFL cheerleader, but she's really ditzy, funny, but she's got a smoking body.
She likes the bigger guys.
Very rough. And she said she likes it. She's a chubby chaser. She goes, I'm a chubby chaser. And she actually really likes this short Chinese guy who's very lovable. He's actually from Texas.
Uh-huh.
He's Chinese and he's from Texas.
Okay.
And very, but he's a really cool guy, but he's short and stout. And they actually got a little thing going. And I'm like, and he's like, I can't believe him with this cheerleader, you know? And so, yeah, I mean, it's, hey, everybody's got their own types and styles. And
Wang Chung, you know, man. Everybody's going to Wang Chung tonight.
Heck yeah.
Or Chung Wang or...
Oh, okay, but yeah. Joan leaves.
Yep, she got...
Says,
oh, well, wait, we got his, he invites... her to, or does he invite her? Yeah, or he invites her to a masquerade. Yes, basically, they're going to go out on a date, and he's got his other girlfriend, and that's getting chick. You know, like
he's like, what are you
going to do about Sandra? You got two girls. What about me? I got none.
Why don't you save one for me? You know,
right? And it's like the whole rest of the movie, he's trying to get one of these chicks from him.
And basically, Wilbur's telling him, no. They're both mine.
Right.
They're both mine.
Yeah, I'll figure out what to do. And I'll figure it out.
And as they're leaving...
Oh, yeah, they got to go let Mr. Talbot out.
They almost forgot, and they say, oh, we forgot Mr. Talbot over there.
Because they got his key.
And he basically... And this is what I don't get, but it's a comedy. And like you said, oh, I love how he just starts tearing into Wilbur. But
see, he's kind of a thin guy. He's not real big there. I'm trying to see the legs.
But he's the room's just a disaster. So, and he wasn't, as the Wolfman, he was not able to leave the room.
No, he's not strong enough to break down a wooden door.
No, but in every other movie he could.
Well,
his father, in the original Wolfman, tied him down to a chair with ropes.
Which he broke out of.
Exactly. But... We'll overlook it, and we are right now.
That's why I stick with the original Universal Cinematic Universe. The original Cinematic
Universe.
This
is not that. This is
that's right.
Just a fun comedy slapstick.
Some people might want to put it, put it in there, but
well,
not me.
I think it's there as part of it, but I mean, you can't.
It's included on the DVD set. Yeah,
even Vincent Price is the Invisible Man at the very end.
Yes, he is.
You know, which
too bad he didn't play the Invisible Man in the one with the Invisible Man. That would have been great.
That would have been
yes.
Anyways,
so what are they doing? They're going to the castle, Dracula's castle here.
Yes,
to pick up Sandra
with
Joan because they're going to go to this masquerade party.
Mm-hmm.
Nobody's got a costume on. They're going to go pick her up, but nobody's got a costume on.
Well, is it in the boat? Maybe they'll come back and get it.
Oh, yeah, I guess they were in a
boat. Or maybe they...
Because you can only get there by motorboat.
Or they... Sandra could have had it at the castle. Man,
play with the big knocker.
Ted, can you believe that knocker, though? How big it is?
Well, it's a big house. I mean, you really got a wham! Wham!
I would love to live in a gigantic concrete castle.
This is like Collinwood, man. Just...
Oh, heck yeah, man. Nope.
So Dr. Stevens answers the door.
Yeah, his big role in the movie.
Yeah, I don't even know why he's here. He's just some naive doctor that's assisting them.
He's going to be
assisting Sandra.
Yeah,
because when they say Sandra here, he's like, "Oh, you mean Dr. whatever Mernoy or whatever?" Because he only knows her.
Myrna Loy,
whatever her name is. Oh, I'll go get her. Whatever.
He will be in love interest kind of to Joan a little bit later on at the masquerade, but not even there.
Masquerade.
Yeah,
whatever.
But Sandra comes down in her lingerie.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, Wilbur.
Who? I told you to come alone.
Yes, why did you bring all these
people? You brought all these other people. Well, I got Wilbur. Chicken Joan and, and...
Chicken Joan!
Chicken Joan!
Chicken Joan!
So now the chicks have to go meet each
chicken
other.
Chicken Joan.
It does, man. Chicken Joan. That'd be a good name for a restaurant that sells burgers.
Chicken Joan.
Yeah, Chicken Joan.
Come on, get your Chicken Joan burger flip flop on zip tie.
Welcome, Chicken Joan. Can I take your order? So who are you?
I'm Joan. I'm his other date for tonight. You bitch.
Would you like to go powder your nose? She's like, yeah, I would.
I'll be right back, Wilbur.
I just have to go get my costume on. Would you like to powder your nose?
Would you like to join me and powder your nose with me? And
powder your nose.
And I like how Wilbur gets all giddy.
I know he's on cloud nine, man. He's got two hoes ready to go.
But also,
he
gets pecks on the cheeks, though. Well, I mean, I guess we don't know what's going on behind the scenes.
For a little chubby guy, man. He's just like who's used to getting nothing. And now he's getting it from every end.
Got to say, I love the hats. I wish top hats like that would come back fedoras. In style. I really do.
We should just start wearing them during the podcasts.
We could.
You know?
Yeah, and cool. Suits. And suits. You want to? Nah, Not too much work.
It's warm enough down here as it is. It's a little warmer down here than usual.
Yeah, you're sweating, aren't you?
I'm a little warm. You've done something.
The air is off because it's finally nice outside.
You don't have no air conditioning on? Heck, we still got the air conditioning on in my house.
Do ya?
Yeah, yeah. Well, I got a pregnant wife. She can't. Yeah, it's at 68. She had the windows when I came home. She had them open for others. There's no breeze.
So she's hot too now. Yeah, being pregnant and all.
Yep.
Wow.
God, it's hilarious.
Oh my God.
And she's eating these nasty ass pickles.
No.
Someone from work, from her job at the doctor's office, like cans pickles. Mm. And it's got garlic and crick water and all kinds of crick water in there.
It's got crick water. Yeah.
And
hey, honey, go get some toilet water.
And I tell you what, it stinks. And after she eats them, it stinks. It's just like point your breath the other way. You know, I can't even sleep facing you.
Well, my
dragon breath.
My one grandmother used to do that too with the pickles. But she would add 2 teaspoons of sugar.
Okay.
Let it sit there, and it would make the regular dill pickles nice and sweet.
Mm-hmm.
And there was nothing like it. It was just 2 teaspoons of sugar.
Well, I mean, a regular pickle is fine, but this has got garlic and crap.
Yeah, it seems like a little too much.
It's a little loud, and I can't take it, man. The whole house smells like this crap.
Mm.
And it seems like she keeps bringing home another jar. I'm like, God damn.
So she's just acting like, I'm pregnant, I need pickles.
She was sitting in the bed eating like watermelon and pickles. Like classic stuff. I'm like, are you pregnant or what? You're sitting there, like, you know, reading your Inquirer magazine. Eating watermelon.
Is she reading Inquirer magazine?
That's all she did. Maybe she likes to read about all them bachelorettes and shit.
Oh no. Okay, where are we at?
I don't know. Well,
we're getting to a really cool scene.
While the girls are upstairs powdering their nose. The phone rings, and for some reason, you know, Chick and Wilbur decide to pick up the phone.
Yes.
And it's Larry Talbot. You know,
he got a hold of
Wilbur. Is that you? He's calling direct. You're at the House of Dracula. You know, you can't be there.
Like, it's not an incognito.
You know, Frankenstein's monster's body's got to be there somewhere. I've traced him to that castle. You know, while you're there, look around.
And he tells Chick, and Chick goes to the phone, and he's off of it.
Right,
now.
And he's about to run out. He's trying to run out of the house.
Yeah.
Like, this is Dracula's castle.
Well, he tells them, hey, Wilbur, let's look around.
Mm-hmm.
Let's look around. So they do start looking around a little bit.
They do.
And, you know,
and as usual in these castles, he goes, there's a secret door.
It's a broom closet.
Yep.
Wilbur tells Chick, it's a broom closet. He goes, move aside.
And you open it. It's like a secret passage or
outside.
Whatever.
But leading outside down to the dock area where the boats and stuff is.
Right.
And this is where you start getting the revolving wall.
They're heading downstairs and I think he just kind of bumps into the wall and brick wall.
Wilbur does.
Like a dungeon kind of wall looking. And it turns.
Lou Costello.
And he goes, what is this? This is like some kind of torture chamber. There's already lit candles and manacles, and it looks like there's a volcano under
the
house.
They're getting ready to.
Look at that fire and stuff. Oh! How did he not see that?
Well, first of all, the Frankenstein monster through this whole movie has got his eyes closed.
Yeah, pretty much.
Why they.
Glenn Strange. He played Frankenstein, I think, in 3 different Frankenstein movies.
But why is his eyes closed?
I don't know. He looks a little like Herman Munster. Look at him sitting on his lap. The Frankenstein monster is sitting in a chair down in this dungeon.
If you call it a chair, it's a throne.
Throne, yeah.
And behind the scenes in this part, Glenn, they kept, you know, reshooting this over and over. And Glenn Strange, who plays Frankenstein, the monster, kept goofing with him too and making him kind of laughing. And
he kept laughing at Costello, thinking he was hilarious.
Because he kept improvising and doing scene after scene.
Because he's sitting on his lap here. He sits down on his lap and starts looking and sees the hand.
Mm-hmm.
He starts hitting the hand.
But you can't see, like, I'm looking to try to see a little smirk on his face.
Yep.
But
yep, there it is right there. Yeah, see?
Right as he gets slides off his... And he goes so slow in his
stilettos. Yeah, he's definitely got like that Pepe Le Pew thing. Like, he'll always end up catching you, but he goes so slow. And he skips around, and Dracula just pops out of the coffin. Ooh,
blah, it's time blah. For me to get up.
Time for a drink.
Ooh, he's got... And this is what's really... I know. But it's a comedy.
Yeah, tag. I mean, look at it. Hey, where'd you go?
So Wilbur gets back to the wall.
Yeah, and the wall
and boom,
turns.
Boom, 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 and it turns, and he's back outside. And this is where he starts to convince Chick. Hey, Chick. He's making a movement. Says Frankenstein, Dracula. Who
he's
got
not even
on.
Talking.
Yeah, he's not talking. It's all like yeah. And so they both get. They both get to the wall. He pushes it, and who turns around? Dracula actually went back, got his coffin.
Yeah.
Frankenstein's there, and they're
on the other side.
Yeah. So it's kind
classic.
Of. Yeah.
It's like something out of Scooby-Doo.
Exactly. Yeah. It's exactly like Scooby-Doo. But then Chick goes off, and Wilbur comes back to the wall and spins around again. And up at the top, for some reason, is Dracula.
He's blocking both ways.
And Frankenstein's down at the bottom. I think, I don't know if they're trying to get rid of his...
He's trying to go up the steps.
Yeah, it's just like really stretching.
Why does he, every time he walks, he has to have the arms out like this? See, Boris Karloff didn't
and
do
he trips,
that.
And
man.
He trips over the last top step. Yeah.
Well, look at those friggin' kiss boots he has to wear.
I know.
You know?
And.
They do it again. How'd the coffin get there again?
Very quickly, yeah.
Because it was down the stairs before.
And the monster's like this, you know. Huddled like very close to the casket. It's just funny.
I don't know.
So they're back on.
I don't know about this damn movie.
They're back on the outside. And you know he's you know they're both sign languaging it. You know Frankenstein, Dracula, they're both here and stuff like that. But I tell you what, man, the set is just great. I don't know where they got
cool.
I don't know where they got the castle. I mean, evidently
left
one of the
over.
Set or,
yeah,
from one of the other movies.
Look at them. Look at these hot chicks getting ready, man. Getting
yeah.
Ready
well, they're the masquerade ball, man. And I don't know if
doesn't really look like a costume though.
Sandra, what is she like? Cleopatra or
no? Joan is snooping, and here's where she's gonna find that journal.
Yes, the book that says.
What does it say? What?
It says
the secrets of life and death
by Dr. Frankenstein. That's
Frankenstein. I am sure I can harness the lightning and extract its life-giving power. I need but one more part to prepare. She's doing that. And she's
giving herself all the time in the world to read this.
Right.
When Sandra is in the next room, and Sandra sees her, actually walks to the next room.
Yeah, like, F this, I'm going to go look through your purse.
Yeah.
And finds out who she is.
She finds out she's an insurance investigator.
Right.
Joan Raymond, insurance inspector. Who back then, they were as big as private eyes.
You think?
Nah.
Probably, man. Like
they were,
Jack.
Yeah, they were in the police stations, you know, getting down and dirty. And that's when she goes, Joan, are you ready for the...
Are you ready to go?
Are you ready to both get wet together in the pool?
At the masquerade.
Oh.
No, man.
And all of a sudden, Chick and Wilbur are back downstairs just... Yeah, they're back in.
He's got like a delayed reaction, getting scared.
They're just back down there, and you know, just waiting
for
the girls.
You remember about their show? Is used to have Joe Besser on it.
Yes,
remember that
the fourth Stooge.
Yeah, yep.
Three
the
Stooges.
Least popular
Joe Besser.
Stooge, I think.
Give me a thing alone.
I didn't think Joe Besser was.
Give me
horrible.
A thing already.
Not so hard.
Not so hard. He was actually pretty. He was good. I mean. You can't, you know, he can't replace Curly or...
No, or Shemp. No,
yeah.
I like Shemp better. I'm a Shemp man myself.
I'm a Shemp man, too.
I love Curly. He's iconic and classic.
And Shemp played many roles back...
My favorite Stooge, Goof on the Roof, is a Shemp episode.
Shemp played in a few Abbott and Costello movies.
Did he really?
Most of the time as a soda boy, a guy behind the fountain. Yeah.
I know he was in some W.C. Field stuff. I know
he
was
like
in the Bank Dick. He worked at a place called, like, the Black Pussy or something like that. Mm. That was, like, the soda shop or whatever.
Yeah, he was always... In the Abbott Costello, he was in the soda shop.
Okay.
He had the restaurant hat on, like, Steak and Shake, and, you know, would make the sodas. And he had bit parts in this. He had bit parts in Charlie Chan films, too.
Did he really? I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Love Shemp.
Yeah.
Shemp Howard.
Shemp played bit roles in a lot of movies.
Some of my favorite
Until he
bits.
Took over... you know, as one of the Stooges, mm-hmm. and then that kind of became part of his main thing.
But I've seen some of his shorts, Shemp shorts.
Yeah.
Shemp shorts.
Shemp shorts.
And I noticed there was one had to do with a mouse trap and everything, and it was a direct copy, because I think his short was first, or maybe the Stooges brought it later. It was a, you know, a Stooge where they...
The Cannon one?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
The Cannon?
Yeah. Yep, with the mousetrap. So, there you go. Maybe they shared ideas.
Which was very, very funny. The mouse.
You know, they crossing had these, the strings or whatever and shooting the cannon off. Yeah, because that's the better mousetrap. A big cannon right in front of your wall.
Not even pointed down at the hole.
No.
It's just pointed straight up, you know, but...
Oh, Dracula's going to show up, and he's going to be...
And he's not in his cape this time. He's in a robe. No,
he's going under an assumed name, Dr...
Bela.
Not Bela.
I don't know.
But something Dr. Cajone or whatever. I don't know. It's something
Dr. else. Dr. Cajones.
So no one actually knows that that's actually Dracula.
You got some cojones.
And they're going to go, and...
Him and Sandra are going to have a big discussion.
Well, Sandra, doesn't she, like, feign a headache or something? Go, oh, you go without me?
Yeah, yeah.
You go without me, and Dracula takes her upstairs, and...
Because she thinks all the plan's blown, because she knows there's an insurance inspector... Looking. Here and catching on to what's going on, maybe. Right.
Uh-oh.
Not true, but... Oh, God.
Bless me.
Bless you.
Must be that cigarette she's smoking.
Yeah. But you love how Bella, the makeup, I mean, it's just so apparent, like, still from, like, 1931. He still wants that white makeup all over him.
Yeah, well, and, probably to cover up all his old wrinkles. Yeah, and plus she saw the journal. She wanted, you know, the jig is up, man. I think we should postpone the experiment, but... No,
We will not postpone it.
Right.
We will go
on. Are we
going
to see his... Don't we see his reflection in the mirror in this scene, too?
I don't know.
I'm almost positive we do.
We'll see. But she does say, you know what? You can
continue. Or it's happened already.
She goes, you can continue on with the experiment. Here's the book. You can do it yourself.
Yeah, you can read.
And he's like, Sandra.
Yes.
Look into my eyes.
It's time for some blood sucking.
Yes, and he slowly creeps to the
creeping
neck.
Creeping on to the neck.
And he goes down and he just... And you gotta love the stare. And he gets...
Oh, look at those craggly old eyes.
Why is it old man?
And you look at the, look at the vampire with the reflection in the mirror.
You just see the reflection in the mirror.
Yeah, so much for that.
Well, did they make a point of that in the old film?
Oh, absolutely. It was a huge part in the old film.
Okay,
absolutely.
Yeah, okay. Well,
yeah, Dr. Van Helsing holds open the thing in front of him and he smacks
right.
Oh, yeah, that's...
Okay, dumb blurb.
Yep, they're not following the
protocol.
They're not following the Universal Vampire Monster Bible. There's a Universal Monster Bible and...
But he sucks blood out of her, and I guess she's one of his creatures of the night.
Creatures of the night.
Creatures of the night. Yeah, so...
You can either sing the Rocky Horror version or the Kiss version.
Mr. McDougal...
Dressed like the devil.
Because they're down at the masquerade now, and for some reason Dr. Stevens is with Joan.
Yeah. McDougal, he assaults Wilbur.
Yeah,
and he's like, "How'd you guys get out of jail?" And
Chick goes, "Yeah, I'd like to see you do that again." He goes, "You don't got a witness.
I'm a witness."
He goes, "Here it is. Do it again. Do it to him again.
Do it to him again."
And here the witness is a guy in an armor knight
suit,
and the thing keeps falling down in front of his face. So you know,
he's totally assaulting him. What the hell?
Unbelievable.
Okay. What was that?
I don't know. It sounds like a...
Fire alarm battery.
Anyways...
There's a fire!
There's a fire alarm.
Okay, so what is this? Is this like in the kitchen or the locker room? This is in the locker room, I think.
Yes.
Because the masquerade's like at a pool or a country club kind of place.
Mm-hmm.
And sure enough, Larry's hanging out in the locker room.
Yes.
And you know, it always seems like...
And he says, have you seen Wilbur or Chick? Like, he just knows they're around there. And
have you seen Wilbur or Chick?
15 seconds later, there they are. And do you like how...
Oh, God, look at that.
Wilbur shows up with a mask. One looks like... I don't know what the one... But anyways, there's a werewolf one, too.
Almost like a ghoul kind of thing. I don't mm-hmm. know if it's supposed to be an actual character or not. But the other one, yes, is important because it's a werewolf mask.
Yeah.
And why is Larry Talbot always coming out at night? you know, to do to this stuff. Them, and I mean, the moon's about to come up in 15 seconds. You're going to be useless to everybody.
Yeah, it makes no sense.
I don't know.
But he does get pissed off at them because of the whole werewolf mask thing.
Right. And they're like, it's not funny.
Yeah. And he nearly...
You wouldn't like it if it happened to you.
Nearly chokes Wilbur to death, you know.
Yeah, you know.
Poor guy.
Wilbur.
And they go out to the masquerade together, and Larry Talbot sees Bella, Count Dracula.
Yeah, there he is.
And Sandra getting off the boat.
And he's like, there he is. That's him. That's him. And he'll just try to say, I'm not Dracula. I'm just wearing a costume. How lame.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't that true, man? Wasn't Bela Lugosi Barry in his Dracula outfit?
I think so, yeah.
That's awesome.
Let's just go with it.
That's awesome. I used to take care at the nursing home. I used to take care of this little Hungarian lady. And I can't remember her name.
Reminded you of Dracula?
No, but I would always ask her because yeah, I knew Bela Lugosi was from Budapest. I'm like, did you know Bela Lugosi? You, I don't know Bela Lugosi.
That's hilarious. But see, yeah, Stephen, Dr. Stevens. There used to be a little
Italian lady, and I used to ask her, hey, you go make me a tombstone pizza. You're going to go make me some Gino's of pizza rolls.
Dr. Stevens is there.
Yeah, yeah.
Danny Devil keeps popping up all through the video.
Well, you know, he needs his own channel, but, you know.
He does. We'll get to it.
We got, go ahead, please.
You gotta work with me here, man. I'm sorry. When that happens. Oh, anyways, so Sandra is, Bella, yeah, he goes off and, Sandra takes Wilbur. Okay, we gotta get back straight onto the
video. Yeah, we're missing stuff.
Sandra's taking Wilbur away.
Right, they're going to go walking. Her intention's to...
Take him back to the castle and...
Yeah.
Well, to bite him.
Yeah, she tries to take a chomp out of him, man.
Which kind of... Isn't that going to void the whole...
I guess if they take the brain out... I guess if they take the brain out, it doesn't really matter. They're just going to dispose of the body anyway.
I don't go for this, no. Not at all, I don't.
Can I tell you this movie is so good?
And do you like how Jones
all these famous comedians think it's so good.
I love back in the day too. They would have
some
lavish
nice hair right there.
They have lavish sets, and they're out in the garden and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. And they have like a chair or a couch type thing that you would have in your living room. Wouldn't it be bug ridden and mold?
Oh, probably
all over
and
it.
Mildewy.
Yeah, I mean,
well, maybe they just put it out there for the evening.
Could be.
Doubt it though. I like the dress she's wearing.
Yeah, here she.
It looks like something out of the original Dracula that the brides wore.
Yes, like Lucy.
You know?
Lucy.
Lucy.
You got a very
it
good
is. It's very. Body. I like those dresses that are kind of flowy. And
here she looks good. She does look good here.
Yeah, with the hair down. Don't look so bad. Uh-oh.
Oh, he poked himself and he's bleeding.
Yep. And she wants that blood.
Yeah, and I don't know if she's technically a vampire now or not. She's one of the undead. We'll say that.
Yeah, I mean, I
don't know if she's fully... she's got to if she's going to be able to transform him here.
I guess.
Because she's going to try to bite him.
I'm confused. Because
she says, look in my eyes.
Look in my eyes and see the
bats. And you see
the
bats.
That is cool.
And is it Bella or Count Dracula through her working on him? I don't know how that
works.
Man,
you're putting way too much in this movie, man.
I think they just thought,
hey, if we put bats in her eyes, it'll
look really
cool.
Yeah.
That's probably all they were thinking.
No, you're probably right.
Man, we're analyzing this as one would analyze Moby Dick. So, yeah, she's about to, but then she ends up getting scared
she's
off.
About
by,
yabba dabba dabba. She's
I'm
about to.
To. What
pump
up,
it up,
Chris?
That's it.
That's what I was born to do. Should we put our clothes on backwards? Crisscross will make you jump.
Crisscross will make you jump. Jump. Okay.
Yeah, why can't they make a comeback? Yeah, Chicken Larry end up...
Were they ever there? Anyways.
I don't know. They end up scaring her off. Scaring her off.
I like how we ramble off and then we gotta catch up. What were we saying?
Well, you know. Yeah. See, that's the cool thing about these movies. You know, it's like, there's a lot of padding, in my opinion.
And that's what makes us go off on these tangents
right,
and have fun.
Let's just go wherever
people
the
flow missing
takes
out on the end.
I would watch the whole thing, man. Who doesn't watch the whole thing? You know, losers.
Well, not everybody. I mean, we of course.
Everyone should be watching the show. Oh my! See, well, this is what I'm talking about.
Yes.
He knows the moon's coming out, and he knows he's putting them in danger.
But he knows also to take his jacket off, his tie, and unbutton the top button.
Right. He doesn't want to screw that shit.
No, he doesn't want to.
And why is he hiding under a log? That was a great transformation scene. There was no cuts or anything.
No.
It was just the nice and smooth.
Nothing moved. Yeah, you could see the hand there.
That was nice and smooth. I really like that. And I do really like, this is not Jack Pierce makeup.
Mm-hmm.
This was when they kind of got rid of him and they started using the foam rubber applications.
So I think they can do it quicker
in some ways. I really like
the ridges on the nose. Do you think he looks better here or the original movie?
There's things that I like better about this one. I think like the nose, the like I said, the ridges that make him look a little bit more dog-like. I notice he's not. Oh God! Yeah, what happened? Was he stuck in the trees or trying to get through them?
Yeah, he was trying to trees. For some reason, he was being dumb and trying to get through the trees. And he thinks Wilbur.
Yeah, he thinks that chick with the mask on and punches him in the face.
Yes, Wilbur does.
Oh God, let's watch the action movements here. God, Wolfman's kind of clumsy.
Yeah, no, he's trying to get him. Well, this is him trying his hardest to try to get Wilbur.
Right, look at him kicking him in the ass.
He's slapping him, punching him, and everything. Because he thinks it's chick. Yeah. And you know what? That you can kind of... It looks like Lon Chaney there.
You know what he's not doing, though, like he did in The Wolfman last week? He's not running on his tiptoes to make him look more dog-like.
Yeah.
See, and that's the thing, man. This one's just for the money.
Oh, yeah. Well,
you know, the original Wolfman, that's a work of art.
They said, hey, this is a comedy. Let's throw in some... Let's not pay as close attention to the monster stuff.
Well, he should have still done it.
He should have. I agree with you.
Because that's his character. And what happens?
They come back to the party, and Mr. McDougal has been...
Bitten on the neck.
The Wolfman took a gouge out of his neck.
Yeah, this happens off camera. We don't see this happen.
Right.
But he claims that, you know, a guy in a wolf mask got me.
And who walks up in the same shirt, slacks, dressed up like Larry Talbot.
Yep, holding the wolf mask. It was you. He said he was going to get me. And then
Wilbur runs up and kind of tells on him and says, yeah, you were doing it.
That to him? You bit him? How could you bite him? And he's like, don't let this little guy fool you. He's an accomplice.
And they take off running like a bird out of hell.
Oh, another half inch and he would have severed his jugular. He's a doctor. Like, he knows.
And you got everybody in their costumes running.
God, all chasing him. Everybody.
Got like the Lone Rangers running back there with...
There's an Indian in there.
Yeah, there's some naked chicks in the back. Just
doing
a pagan dance ritual. Damn, like the Wicker Man. And Wilbur just runs up and...
Smacking a Dracula.
There's Dracula. And he's got his capes blocking everything but his eyes. And he turns into a bat right in front of him.
It's true. Walter Lance, courtesy of Walter Lance. I don't even see the wire holding the bat up. That's a real bat.
Yeah.
That's a good bat.
Look
at this. This is awesome. This mist and everything he's running
through. It's the creature from the Black Lagoon.
I was just going to say that. That would have been awesome out of that.
I mean, you could see the big yacht,
mm-hmm.
you know, right there.
And then what's her name? Joan.
Joan is a gypsy.
She's already hypnotized.
She's a gypsy.
She looks like she's something that gypsy.
I would have taken advantage of that, her being hypnotized there.
You would have completely abused her, huh?
Yes, I would have said, Joan, you must do the... Okay.
Do what I tell you to do.
Yes, do what I tell you.
Make me a sandwich.
Make love to me. You know, I love in these old movies, making love to them was like giving them a kiss.
That's right.
Oh, she made love to me.
Oh, God, look, he hypnotizes a chick.
From 10 feet away with just one glance.
He's hypnotizing everybody.
You know?
See, I tell the
And girls don't you love work. The great scene where Dracula needs the boat to take
he's
off?
He's driving the boat.
Yeah, with you know, Wilbur
he's
and
Joan.
He's
driving the boat. I tell the girls at work, I go, here's, you know, not about making love or anything. But
make a love.
I was like, if you want to keep your husband happy, there's three rules. Rule, I probably shouldn't even, if there's ladies out there, I shouldn't even tell you this.
Okay.
Rule number one, make him a sandwich once in a while without him asking for it. Just, he's watching TV, you just go, hey, honey, here's a sandwich.
Never happened.
All right. Number two, you know, you do your wifely duties once in a while, all right? And the third one.
Every other day.
Whatever. If that. And, you know, when it's been a long time, who cares? And number three is just don't talk so much. We don't need to hear all the minutiae of your day.
The minutiae.
Now, I want to point out to everybody, number one was sandwich. All right?
Oh,
sandwich number one. Before anything else, just sandwich.
Never had a sandwich made for myself.
No, I mean, never when you're sitting there watching the game or whatever, just, here, hon, have a sandwich.
And you need a lot of the yada yada.
Yeah,
you know, just, you know, hey, honey, I just got home from work. Yada, yada, yada. Good night.
Good day. Yeah. Good night. That's pretty much what we want.
That's awful.
And if there was a number four, it would be just please understand that yes and no are perfectly acceptable answers to every question you ask us.
Yes.
When we're talking with guys, it's different.
No.
Oh, God. So what did I gloss over here? Larry Talbot wakes up in the morning. You know, he's all, you know, Larry Talbot-ed again. He comes across Chick. Because they're being hunted. Everybody's hunting this. They're hunting for,
the dogs
for Chick.
Yes, the dogs are chasing down Chick. And they basically both get up together and run off to the castle.
Right.
Where we get to the scene where...
That's some cool... Cool makeup right there.
And like you actually do see his eye just a little bit.
Just
there.
A little.
I don't know if it's the makeup or the way they did it or what, but for some reason, yeah, they went cheap on it and didn't have his eyes open. I don't get it. But anyways.
But they're back in that little like torture chamber that they're in before. And
he's
Wilbur's in like some kind of stockade sort of thing. It's just around his neck.
He's a pilgrim.
I don't know. And the Frankenstein monster is sitting in the throne again, and I think Sandra's down there, but she's all like, you know, hypnotized, waiting for Dracula to get
out. Yeah, Wilbur's going, Sandra,
Sandy,
can't you help?
Sandy, come on, this is really weird. It's like, come on,
it's like,
Sandy,
come on, man,
get me out of here,
help me. And he actually was saying, trying to get Frankie.
Look, he's
too.
Got a smirk on his face there. You knew
he
something.
Does.
Something happened.
Something funny.
Oh yeah,
happened.
He's trying the ring again on the bolts.
Yeah, look
and
at that.
It's not working.
He's running low on fuel.
He's getting weaker. We must do the operation.
We must work quickly to get his
getting
voltage,
weaker.
His voltage back. Is he getting weaker? Is
he's
this,
getting
or is,
weaker.
Or is that ring losing its power?
The ring has endless supply of power. It's the ring of power.
The ring has ultimate electricity flowing through
ultimate
it.
Ultimate electricity.
I gather it from the air.
Ah.
Oh, man. But Sandra goes up and starts rubbing his heart.
And this is like where she's going to tell him what the whole plan is. The thing I told you like an hour ago.
Well, he thinks she's hitting on him because she goes, you know.
But really, she said, you know, I've got an idea.
Tell me. We're
going to be big. And you're going to be, you know, she's you're going to be big and strong. You're going to be strong as an ox, she says.
Yes.
And
he goes,
you'll
really
live
tell
forever.
Me more.
You'll never die.
Oh, Sandy.
Oh, how are you going to do that, Sandy?
Sandy, like, you're so queer.
We're going to take
you're
your
so
brain
queer.
Out and... Put him into Frankenstein's monster. Chick! Oh, look in the back. They're in the lab now. There's all that lightning thing. That just reminds me of...
it's not going to burn anything up.
That reminds me of the Ed Wood movie, the Tim Burton movie.
Yeah.
When they're showing the making of Bride of the Monster. It's one of those Jacob letters.
With
And Ed Wood's telling... it was Martin Landau.
We're going to wall just open up.
I know. Telling me that he's going to stand by that and you know, be working on something. He's like, I'm not getting anywhere near that fucking thing. That's what it reminds me of. And see, he's nice and far away from it this time, too.
Yeah. I love that scene there that you just seen where...
seen what I saw when I saw it.
Count Dracula's sitting there with Dr. Stevens, the guy.
Yeah.
And he's basically telling Dracula, I'm not doing this. I'm not agreeing with what's going on here and stuff. And he's just going like this. And Sandra comes out and she picks this thing off of the wall.
Yep.
Hits him over the head.
Yeah.
And he goes, very good. Good job. You know. And it's like, he's Dracula.
I know. All he had to do is like that little Dracula mind trick.
Yeah. All he had to do is go like this.
Bite him on the neck and now he's got to do what you say.
Oh. So he opens up the fake.
Oh, and we get a scene in between... Chick and Larry have arrived at the island in a rowboat.
Mm-hmm.
They rowed across the ocean.
They rowed.
And they're going to...
They're
getting
rowed,
inside.
They
found the entrance into the castle.
Yes, they did.
So look at... Oh, they come in with Dr. Steven and just into that little torture room, which is on a gurney. Just dump him over.
Yeah.
I don't know if he's... Do we even see him again in the movie?
No.
We don't know
all.
If he's dead, alive.
Oh, wait. I'm not sure. Is he in the very last scene? No, he isn't.
I don't recall, but we'll find
out. The gasoline scene. But anyway.
I just watched this morning, and go figure.
Yeah. But yeah, he...
I always remember, yeah.
He tells... Dracula brings the gurney up to the monster, and he says... Mm-hmm. He goes, get on the gurney.
Get on.
That's not what he says.
He's like, yes, master.
He goes, oh, I am so...
Yeah, because this is... I think Glenn Strange in the previous films hadn't talked. I don't think Frankenstein had talked since... No, he did talk. Well, he talked in Bride of Frankenstein. And then there was another movie, I can't remember which one it is, where Frankenstein monsters... Igor gets it, who's played by Bela Lugosi, gets his brain put into Frankenstein. So he talked in that one. I think that was Glenn Strange in that.
And the other movie he talked to, he said,
You know, Basil Rathbone's in a couple, in one of them too. So, you know, we got all the actors that we love. We love Basil Rathbone.
Basil Rathbone played everyone's the like, bat, who? The Bat.
That's a good name. If I have a son, that's be a good name. Basil.
Yeah, Basil. Basil.
No, my wife
would go for that. Corporate.
She wouldn't go for it.
No, I know. Women.
Boris. She wouldn't go for Boris. I even tried Vincent Boris. Leonard, because that was Vincent Price's name. I was like, how about Vincent Leonard?
Oh, that's actually a really good one.
I know. Because she knows where it comes from. But I told her, you know, she named the other two, so this one's
that's
mine.
That's how you name your children sometimes, right, man.
I know.
Anyways,
so they get, they're taking Frankenstein's creature away. They're going to come back and get Wilbur.
Yes.
But in the interim, is it Larry or it's Larry interim. And Chick? Oh, yay, we do see him again. They revive Dr. Steven, get him out of there. They bust Lou out. And I'm sorry,
Wilbur. With a rock. Of course, Chick puts it on his hand.
Yeah.
As he's trying to get
out.
He's going, oh, no.
And they get out. They get out of the castle, but not for long.
No.
Well, because they're going to get back on the boat.
Well, what's Larry doing? Talbot, the Wolfman. It's nighttime again.
Yeah, he's going to turn into Wolfman in about 2 seconds. So Dracula
in about 2 seconds. He's going to change in about 2 seconds.
They come down to go get Wilbur. Sandy. Wilbur's gone. We must find them.
Yeah,
release the hounds. Well, actually, he doesn't even walk. He hypnotizes Wilbur from, like, you know, 8,000 feet away.
Well, he's got control of his mind still, I guess.
Wilbur, you will come to me.
Yes, you will.
Wilbur.
And I like how he's like, ignores it for a second and goes and starts untying the rope again. And then
Wilbur. I love how he does that, man. He's,
with his hands.
Yes, but I mean, he gets like the fingers all pointed down.
He's so intense. He's
bitching, man.
That's
what a great character.
The Lugosi hypnos.
You know, and that's right. Universal did owe it to
Lugosi. Do the Lugosi.
You're going to go and do this film and hire someone else to be Dracula? No one else should have played Dracula but Bela Lugosi.
Exactly. Yeah, I agree.
Man, just after that first movie, he should have played him. You had...
He was so
John
hard
Carradine
to...
John Carradine playing him.
He was so difficult, though. I mean, God, I mean, you know, you're... I don't know if it was just like drugs or if it went back that far, which probably did.
You know, I'm not sure. I'm not sure if back then if he...
But he was a very
difficult man. It was mostly when
he
started not getting the roles anymore, I think. You know, here in the 30s and 40s, he was still getting work.
Mm-hmm.
But coming up soon here, I think that's going to dry up.
Well, this is 48, so this is pretty much towards the end of, you know, it all for Bella. So. I mean, you know, what was the next thing was the Ed Wood, pretty much, right?
Yeah, I mean, anything that he could get, pretty much. Anything that he could get, you know, any part you can get. So,
the brain that wouldn't
he
die.
He calls Wilbur back to him, which he does. And the other guys
realize... If you're that close to that electrical...
I gotta think that's animated.
Oh, it is. I mean, just like the animated earlier.
There's electricity flying every which way around here. And
I wasn't saying in real life they were going to get electrocuted. I'm just saying... Right. In happenstance, the scene you're watching, the bolts going around like that, the Tesla coil and stuff like that, so close to them, they would have gotten electrocuted.
Probably.
But,
She's about to, Sandra, she's got she put a mask on for sterility.
Yes.
And she's about to carve into, and he's like, how about some ether? She's like, don't worry, you won't feel a thing. He's got a scalpel about ready to cut into his skull.
Yes. Without no anesthetics or nothing.
Larry and Chick bust in. and Larry's helping release Wilbur. But of course, you know, for some reason, he opened... The full moon's coming through.
Mm-hmm.
And basically, as he's releasing him, he turns back into the Wolfman.
Right.
I mean, he's useless.
And he's on the gurney, strapped down, next to Frankenstein, who's strapped in.
Exactly.
Okay?
Exactly.
So, at this point,
Chip runs off, trying to lead people away from Dracula, away from everybody else.
And craziness ensues between the Wolfman and Dracula. Pretty much. And Wilbur is on the gurney table, spinning around.
Oh, yeah. There's that one part they spin him, and I swear to God, this part right here. Look at this. He spins for it like... It's like 12 spins.
Yeah, no.
Look at that. I mean, he ain't stopping.
And Glenn Strange. I was going to say Robert Strange.
Robert Strange. Glenn Strange. He's just sitting there relaxing.
Frankenstein Monster goes...
You know, you should go online if you haven't and look at a picture of Glenn Strange. See what he actually looked like. And that was the reason he got the role of Frankenstein, because of his face. He did have like kind of a weird kind of deep set, you know, face and... And
was this the only thing that he ever did?
He did other things too.
Did he? Okay.
Yeah, he did. I mean, he was an actor, but they saw him on the lot, whatever. And it's like that face must be Frank.
That face, that face,
that beautiful that face,
that cover girl face. It glows. It shows.
Oh, here's the best part.
That true makeup face.
Frankenstein's monster busts out of the gurney. He picks up Sandra.
Yes.
And basically just chucks her ass out the window. She's gone. She's dead.
Yes, he killed her.
Chucks her out the
window. And I think it's because he knows what was going on.
Well, yeah, but then he's starting to... I mean, Chick and Wilbur didn't do anything. He's going after them. Look, they run out of the lab into a bedroom, and look how easy this oak bed moves.
Oh, yeah, it's on wheels.
Well, they must have, like, those sliders underneath the posts.
And you like how they jump on top of it?
Right. And look, the top of the door opens.
Yes.
He's not getting in here. He's not getting in here.
But they're on top of it to where, even if it was pushed, it would...
Yeah, they
would
have fell right out.
You know. But,
and, the Frankenstein monster comes in there, they, you know, run around, cover
Wilbur's holding the back of Chick's,
his body.
Chick's, belt, his pants.
Look at Dracula, man, he's throwing flower pots at the Wolfman.
Yeah, the fight scenes weren't the greatest in these movies.
I think they're fantastic. It's Dracula throwing a flower pot at the Wolfman.
Take that, you sons of bees.
Take that,
you son of a bitch. He's got a
chair. Yeah.
He's trying to tame him.
Oh, Frankenstein got loose. Oh, God, look at this. They're out in the hallway. Oh, isn't that awesome?
Wilbur takes his, pulls the thing out from underneath the candelabra, and it's still lit.
Yeah, when you try the tablecloth thing, the trick. And he stops for a second. He's all impressed. But the reason he did it is because he puts it over his face like Dracula to fool the Frankenstein monster.
And he goes, and he brings it down because he was fooling him. And he drops it and goes, see, I told you. And then Frankenstein...
I told you it worked.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, you're right. His eyes are closed, man.
Oh, yeah. He doesn't...
I wonder why.
I don't. Maybe they for this was the cheapest
one. I'm
gonna
watch the other films with him in it, and I'm gonna have to notice if he closed his eyes the whole time.
I think this was the cheapest one made, and maybe they used one of the masks.
It didn't even cost $1 million. This movie cost.
Maybe they used one of the masks that he used, but the eyes were closed in it. But that was the one they could use, and they used it through the movie.
Movie was about $800,000 and made over $3 million. And Bud and Lou, they got $105,000 to split. Wow. So $105,000 out of that $800,000 was theirs.
Pretty good for back then. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
So
it's like a few years' paycheck, you know.
Yeah. So what happens? A Frankenstein monster busts through the door.
Wolfman jumps.
Oh yeah, because Dracula's going to escape.
Yes.
He's going to turn into a bat on the balcony.
Mm-hmm.
And then what were you going to say? I'm sorry.
Oh no! And he was going to fly away and. The Wolfman jumps and leaps and catches the bat, and they both fall to their death.
And you can tell that splash is sort of either
animated,
or
had Walter Lance do all those effects.
Yeah,
in this movie.
You can tell, but it looks kind of cool.
It does.
Yeah, so, but you could tell. And,
no, I like how they added that in here. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's really so made the movie.
Evidently, that's all you need to do to kill the Wolfman and Dracula.
Put them in water.
Yeah. And running water with vampires, they don't like running water. Well, no, that was Hammer. That's established in the Hammer Dracula movies. They don't like the running water.
There you go.
Frankenstein monster still lumbering around the grounds of the castle.
Mr. McDougal and another guy is there.
Somehow they took a boat over to the castle, and they're there.
Mm-hmm.
And yeah, so once Dracula dies, like Joan comes out of that spell, and that's Dr. Stevens. Yeah. That I should have remembered he was in it because he's the one that sets fire here. He tells her to get the gas cans. Yeah,
that's what I thought. That's what I was telling you. You numbnut.
Now here, this is the part I was talking about.
Yes.
So Bud and Lou, they get in a motorboat. They're trying to get away.
Mm-hmm.
And Frankenstein monster is on the pier throwing barrels at them.
Yes.
And the boat is tied to the pier. And you keep hearing Chick's voice saying, "Cut the rope! Cut the rope, will ya? Cut the rope! Cut the rope!" Now, Glenn Strange had a little mishap on the set, where he knocked over a camera, it fell on his foot, and I think maybe broke a couple of toes. So he couldn't do this particular scene. So, because he had done it before, this is actually Lon Chaney dressed up as Frankenstein, throwing those barrels and all this crap, and doing this last scene here. So,
wow.
So that's why you don't get like a real, you know... Yeah, I mean, look, I don't know if...
I mean, yeah.
I don't know if that's Glenn right there or if that's Lon. I can't tell. Because they could have filmed that at some other point.
Right, right.
Here. But yeah, you can tell it's a man. So
you could tell this is just like two by fours. 2x4s up the pant legs.
Well, here's what I don't understand. The mannequin, I mean, sorry, Professor Stevens and Joan, they get all the gas and they pour it all over the pier and he sets fire to the pier. So the Frankenstein monster is kind of between the water and the fire. And he chooses to walk into the fire and die. Instead of jumping into the water and maybe live.
And here we get the very great scene, the very ending that ends really quick. The Visible Man pops up.
Right. Bud and Lou are on the boat and they're saying, well, you know, that's all over with. And it's like, well, there's nobody else left that can scare us. And that's when it's Vincent Price's voice and it's so great. Because he's like, oh, and I was hoping to get into the fun. I was
hoping to get into the fun.
Yeah, and you see a cigarette come up in the air and light and start blowing and... And he's like, I'm the Invisible Man. Yeah, and they jump out of the boat, swim away, end of story.
Yes.
So there
and
we
that
go.
Was, and I'm telling you, if you love the Universal Monster movies.
It's the ultimate of the mashems, I guess. You know?
Mashup, yeah. But man, Abbott and Costello, I can't say enough about them. This movie, I can't say enough about this. And if you do... enjoy this. Watch Abbott Costello Meet the Mummy and The Invisible Man.
There's actually a DVD both really set. Great. I think it's two discs, and it's got all those movies. Just the Universal Monster movies. The Invisible Man, The Mummy, Boris Karloff, you know, Frankenstein's on there. It's like two per disc or something like that. Right. So, I mean, you can buy a little set that's got them all and actually, you know, sort of complete your collection in a way.
Yeah, man.
But, unfortunately, I feel like we couldn't remember all the good one-liners in this. Because Abbott and Costello, their banter in between each other is what made them great.
Yes.
And we can't do justice to that with that. We can kind of just, you know, a few bits and pieces that we remember. But they're very fast. Rapid fire.
Oh, yeah.
And they have...
That's what makes it Abbott and Costello.
Right.
Is I mean, them and their banter back and forth.
They
and
had
like
a long
you said,
career. Yeah. Did have a little bit of a falling out for a little while, but then kind of made up towards the end of their lives.
Yeah.
Both of them tried to go sort of solo and with other partners, and it never worked out. Never worked out. So
yeah, because believe it or not, they had a little bit of a falling out. And
It was over a housekeeper. I think Costello had fired a housekeeper, and Abbott hired her.
Yeah, something
and
like that.
And they had some kind of a falling out about that, and...
you wonder if
and walls actually, could talk. Things for Lou change. He had a son that died young, drowned in a pool.
Yeah,
when he was on the set of a movie or a radio show or something like that, and that really took a lot of the zap out of him. I think, from what people who knew him said, and I think it was even in an episode of Sopranos. But there is a statue of him over in Jersey. You know, because that's where
well,
he
this
was
movie
from.
Too is in the. Oh, what is it in? Something in Hollywood. I mean, it gets its recognition.
Oh, it's like on the, you know, American Film Institute's top 100 comedies. Yeah. It's like number 56 on the list. And, or, you know, any list of top comedies, this is on there. I don't find it as funny as some people do. I've seen it a bunch of times. And the parts with Abbott and Costello are funny. I just think the story's just a little thin is all. And, I don't dislike it.
I just
thought I'd come at it from a little bit of a different angle. Yeah. But people love this movie. And I just thought it was funny because I didn't realize before that Lou didn't really like it.
Yeah.
I thought it was kind of dumb. And then they ended up making like four more of them, you know, with other monsters.
But they could have been looking at it like you did. I mean, you know, with the continuity of the monsters and like, what are you just going to throw the monsters in there?
Yeah, maybe that's what he didn't like about it.
And maybe he didn't know that Bella was going to play the Dracula. It sounds like
once they got to making it and having the fun in between takes and stuff like that, that he, you know, hey, it was a good experience. So yep. Sounds like in the end he came around and liked it. So
cool.
There we go.
So that's there.
This
we go,
is a
man.
Very easily able. You know, you can find this movie anywhere. Yeah, and I think you know you guys should give it a try. It's not part of the canon as far as I'm concerned.
Right.
But awesome.
No. I would say to throw in, this is your movie to watch to get into Abbott and Costello, and I would.
Yeah, and they've got better stuff than this.
So. Oh yeah, I would. Well, yeah. Yeah, I would urge
even
you.
Even just their classic routines. Yeah, everybody knows who's on.
Oh, Abbott and Costello in the Navy is mm-hmm. probably one of their best comedies.
Or what's the other one? Is it?
Buck Privates.
That's what I was thinking. That's one of their first movies.
Yeah, they're all good. I mean, but this horror wise,
but you could go on YouTube good. Probably and catch some of their little routines and stuff like that.
Oh, yeah,
and,
yeah.
Or if you have old-time MeTV, I mean, everybody's got MeTV. The Abbott and Costello show's on there. I think every weekend.
So. And the old-time radio shows, if you can look that up too and find those anywhere on the internet. So. Mm. So there you go. I think next week we're going to do Frankenstein.
Yes, and I've got a lot of cool stuff to add to it. So
lots of info.
It's not going to be just here's Frankenstein and we're going to talk about it. I got a nice article at home all about Mary Shelley and what was going on scientific-wise
mm-hmm.
When she wrote the story, what they actually knew back then and how she incorporated it in her story. So I'm going to bring that with me and we'll kind of... try to make it something a little bit different. So that's one to watch.
Oh, yeah. Cool. And I think this was an excellent one, too. And I hope subscribe and all that good stuff. The Late Late Horror Show.
Yes.
So, and if you want and you like to just listen to the podcast part of it, because YouTube kind of takes up a lot of data. I've learned that this is... the longer that goes on your show and on YouTube, it's a data thing with cell phones and tablets and stuff like that. And... your carriers and all that, but we're going to continue to do what we do
right. This
way. I also put it up on SoundCloud, iTunes, and find us on Facebook. If you made it to this point and you're still listening, the Late Late Horror Show is up on Facebook. Check it out. Update it all the time. We used to be the Little Monsters Movie Podcast. Now we're the Late Late Horror Show. And
easier to find on YouTube.
Easier to find.
Type in horror. That was a good idea of yours.
Yeah. So
we weren't showing up on those searches if you were searching for horror channels and shows. We weren't showing up. Can't have that. We're the best one.
We have fun.
Day and this time Heck slot, yeah. we're the best one.
So anyways, with that said, the Late Late Horror Show is out. And we'll see you next week, man. Later.
Later, Monster Squad.